sleep is gone, my heart is full of sorrow. I can't believe how much I've let you down. Dread the pain that waits for me tomorrow. When the sun reveals my broken dreams scattered on the ground, please forgive me. I need your grace to make it through. All I have is you. I'm at your mercy. Lord, I'll serve you till my dying day. Help others find a way. I'm at your mercy. Please forgive me. I can't believe the God of earth and glory would take the time, care for one like me. But I read in the Bible that old story, how he pled for my forgiveness while he was dying on a tree. Please forgive me. I need your grace to make it through. All I have is you. I'm at your mercy. Lord, I'll serve you till my dying day. Help others find a way. I'm at your mercy. I need your grace to make it through. All I have is you. I'm at your mercy. Please forgive me.
Now God spoke to Moses at the burning.
dream mother walked up the heavenly stairs, and medals for mothers were given up there. They mentioned a million things Mom did for me, things I took for granted and never could see. If there's medals for mothers for all of the deeds they have done, if there's medals for mothers, Mama, kind love and care, a medal for duty she won up above. But the biggest of all was the one for her love. If there's medals for mothers for all the they have done, if there's medals for mothers, Mama, you'll win every one. Yes, Mama,
Mama taught me how to give, Mama taught me how to live, Mama taught me how to read the Word of God. And if you lose your way, all you have to do is pray, and your life will be led by the storm. That star is Jesus Christ, who came to give his life on Calvary's cross. Christ was paid in full. If you will believe, then you will receive eternal life and all it ensures. Mama said to read the Word. It's the voice of God you heard. It's the power of God to all who believe. It's peace to the troubled soul. It's God's hidden goal. It's Moses' rod to all who achieve. Mama said he's coming soon. Could be morning, night, or noon. Pays to have your name in the book of life. You may be the upper class, you may be running fast, or you may be the world's biggest crook. That star is Jesus Christ, who came to give his life on Calvary's cross. Christ was paid in full. If you will believe, then you will receive eternal life and all it ensures.
darkness of the room, I became a masterpiece in the coldness of a tomb. But it's beyond all comprehension how life turns into art. When you painted me with Calvary's blood, I became a work of art. I'm not picture perfect, just ordinary clay, and I still feel the master's brush on my life from day to day.
Let's all go down to the river. There's a man that's walking on the water. Come along with me, for I want to see this man walking on the water. Well, he can raise the dead from the grave, change the water and turn it into wine. He can make the lame walk. He can make the lame walk. Open up the eyes of the blind. Let's all go down to the river. There's a man that's walking on the water. Come along with me, for I want to see this man walking on the water. Well, Jesus is the man at the river, and he's washing people's sins away. He can save your soul if you give him control. Be ready for that judgment day. Let's all go down to the river. There's a man that's walking on the water. Come along with me, for I want to see this man walking on the water. This man walking on the water.
I sleep is gone. My heart is full of sorrow. I can't believe how much I've let you down. I dread the pain that waits for me tomorrow. Sun reveals my broken dreams scattered on the ground. Please forgive me. I need your grace to make it through. All I have is you. I'm at your mercy. Lord, I'll serve you till my dying day. Help others find the way. I'm at your mercy. Please forgive me. I can't believe the God of earth and glory. Take the time to care for one like me. But I read in the Bible that old story, how he pled for my forgiveness while he was dying on a tree. Please forgive me. I need your grace to make it through. All I have is you. I'm at your mercy. Lord, I'll serve you till my dying day. Help others find a way. I'm at your mercy. I need your grace to make it through. All I have is you. I'm at your mercy. Please forgive me.
Now God spoke to Moses at the burning.
Morning. I'd like to welcome everyone to Hickox Baptist Church this morning. Brother Charlie, how about opening us in prayer this morning? Amen. This morning they had the pancakes and things over for the mothers. Hope you attended that and enjoyed it. Yesterday they had a ladies' tea here. If you didn't take part in that, you missed a good time. These women around here know how to put on a tea party. But we had some. There was 106 at it yesterday. But we, Miss Karen allowed me to get some help. And I brought in some people that hadn't ever been to a tea party. But it was a good time. There was a bunch of little girls there. They had their own little table. So they had a good time. On the 21st of May, we're going to have a grad day. And there's going to be refreshments to follow. Please bring finger foods. And also on the 21st, there'll be a church conference following the evening service. On the 29th of May, the office will be closed for Memorial Day. On June the 3rd, there's a lot going on around here at the church. There's going to be a VBS kickoff. I'm not sure of the time right now. 11 to 3. So join us for a fun-filled event. They're going to have water slides. They're going to have some food. They're going to have some games, I think, and some the snow biz truck's going to be here. Little snow cones. Then you get a 3-hour break. And there's going to be a youth night of worship at Hickox Baptist Church at 6 p.m. The guest speaker is going to be Mac Pitts. And there's a praise and worship band coming called the Bearded Moose. It's going to be interesting. And then June the 4th through the 8th, Bible school starts. So please sign up to help for that. There's a sign up sheet on the bulletin board. There's a couple of more days that you get to sign up on your own free will. And then we'll go into drafting people. According to Brother Jamie, that was his thoughts. There's a thank you note in your bulletin that says, thank you so much for the beautiful flowers you sent for our sweet daddy. They are still beautiful and we sincerely appreciate them. He loved everyone at Hickox Baptist Church and truly enjoyed attending church with all of you. Please continue to remember our family in your prayers. Our hearts are absolutely broken. We love you all, the Charlie Riggins family. That's Brother CW's family. And the kids' ministry. Listen to this one. The kids' ministry will be at Derek and Laney's house next Wednesday night. I'm assuming they're going to come here and then go to your house. So you bring the kids here, then they're going to go to Derek and Laney's. Wear old clothes. Kids are going to be in the garden during your time of church. So they're going to get them a growth lesson. I don't know how he's tying that in exactly, but it's going to go on with seeing how things the Lord has provided us with. And he needs a little help digging taters. So anyway, but says, for all the kindness you have shown, we thank you very much, the family of Jim Mohandas Power. That's a thank you note in there also. And I probably mispronounced that. I apologize. We had 75 in Sunday school this morning. Also, after the singing, we're going to do the singing first, and then there's going to be a Mother's Day little drawing for a couple of gifts that's been here. So if you're a mother and you came in and didn't get a ticket or a flower, raise your hand and we'll see that you get one. Sir?
Just the ladies.
Just the ladies.
Not mother, lady, any lady.
No, it's mothers. any mother. And I'll be right back there at the back. If you didn't get one, just turn around and look at me, and I'll make sure you get one. Thank you.
Miss Knowles didn't raise her hand, Jared. But, oh, she got it? I'm sorry. I don't want anybody to sneak away. We had almost all the doors covered this morning. Miss Marilyn didn't get one? All right. Well, we want to do that. Right now, if you are a mother and you have got a flower, and if you're up here in the choir and you don't have your flower, y'all got to raise your hand. Y'all hold your flowers up. Y'all see that, guys? If it weren't for them, none of us would be here. Let's give them a big clap. How about that? I always think at the end of every flower, there is a biscuit waiting for you guys. Amen, amen. But it is good to have you. Happy Mother's Day to each one of you. I think about around 60 people participated this morning for the parfaits and pancakes. And yes, I tasted it and everything was safe for y'all to eat. So anyway, thank everyone that done that over there too as well. So this morning, we're going to sing fast and we're going to sing short, and then we're going to get into Mother's Day stuff and then the message. We got a few specials to go along with us, but we're going to ask the choir to stand and you to sing with us and stand. This is the day. The sound of these sweet angel mamas and women singing in the church. So you girls have at it. Let's sing. This will be an offertory hymn. We have come into the house. That's what we're here for. Thank you.
and in your king and your coming and in your path. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to sing one more. Y'all stand and help us. The family of God. Thinking of Mother's Day when I pick this song out. We come together. We're all one family.
Jesus, as you travel.
to your seat, not home. All right, if you'll get back to your seats, we got a couple of specials. We got Brother Allen, I think Brother Ronnie, going to sing us one. Brother David might even help him, I don't know. And then we got one more. Where's she at? There she is. So you come on up here, girl. Y'all go ahead, guys.
Blue and orange, Terry. Blue and orange.
Hello. Hello. Am I on there?
There's a light in the window. The table is spread in splendor. Someone standing by the open door. I can't see the crystal river, so I've never, forever, I've never been this homesick before. See the bright light shine, it's just about home time. I can see my father standing at the door. Wilderness, I'm ready for deliverance. Lord, I've never been this homesick before. I can't see the family gathered, sweet faces all familiar. No one's older people anymore. Oh, this lonesome heart is crying. I think I spread my wings for flying. Never been this homesick before. See the bright light shine. It's just about home time. I can see my father standing at the door. This world has been a wilderness. I'm ready for deliverance. Lord, I've never been this homesick before. Lord, I've never been this homesick before.
Cause I see the bright light shine.
It's just about home time. I can see my father standing at the door. This world has been a wilderness. I'm ready for deliverance. Lord, I've never been this homesick before. Lord, I've never been this
used a minute, just a little time alone, but you let me be your little shadow, following wherever you would go. Then I got a little older, and you gave me space to grow. I don't ever seem to tell you enough, but I want you to know, when God made you my mother, He knew who I'd need. When He picked you from the others, He could already see that you would be my hero and everything to me. I come to you with all all my secrets. And you never ever judge. And when I'm falling in my weakness, you give me strength to stand back up. No amount of miles could separate us. No place where I don't feel your love. You say I'm the gift that heaven gave you. But mama, I'm the lucky one. 'Cause when God made you my mother, He knew who I need. When He picked you from the others, He could already see that you would be my hero and everything I wanna be. When God
Sierra, McKaylee, this one, he got so many I can't keep up with them, to help me. We're doing something a little different, kind of got this from another church or somebody, how we want to choose three women. The only fair way to do it is we're going to draw for it this morning. How about that? But before we do that, I do want, JJ, come on. I got her to draw because she's a female. And if I draw and don't get your number, then you're going to be mad with me. I'd rather be mad with her. But just from that aspect. But to recognize a few folks here, the oldest mom here, is there anyone here older than 80 years old? 80 years old. Miss Montalou? Anybody? 85? How old is Miss Marilyn? You don't know? 81. Brother Charlie, she's 81. Okay. Well, let's give Ms. Montalou a big hand. She's 85 years old. Still got her daughter coming with her. That's a wonderful thing, Ms. Montalou. Thank you so much for being loyal to our church. Now, the youngest mother here. No, Brother Charlie, she's... Yeah. Let's go 20 years or younger. If you're a mom and you're 20 years or younger, will you please stand? Hey. I was fitting to say, we in the church house, girl. We can't be telling that kind of stuff. 25 years and younger, and you got a child, you're a mother. Y'all started later than I did. 30 years and younger. Oh, boy, I knew that would do it. All right, how old are you? 29. She's been 29 several times. Anyway, how old are you?
26.
26 and 28. Really? Let's give her a hand this morning. All our young ladies that have one. And I kiss all their babies all the time. I don't know. They don't mind. Some of you older girls, y'all hate it. But anyway, now, the mother... who's got the most kids? Nah, I don't care if they're not here. If you had 8 or more kids and you're a mom, anybody here with that? How many siblings you got?
There's four of us.
Four. Anybody got more than four? You got four. Four or more? Four or more. I forgot about them. Man, I'm telling you what. Yeah, that bunch over there. I want y'all to stand because y'all do need a hand of applause. There you go. Hey. Hey. And they still standing, okay? Good thing in the house of the Lord. They might have drug all them youngins here, maybe. That'd be good. All right, but this morning, what we're going to do, we got your tag number, and we got a gift. Popcorn. Can y'all hear that? McKaylee?
Yes.
Do the best you can. If you pick your mama's, you're in trouble.
I thought it'd be funny if she still won.
All right. All right, what is the number? Talk into my mic.
3643.
That's the last four digits. 3643. Some of y'all put your glasses on. Small numbers. 3643. You need to check, see if Camille or Courtney might have that number. So we'll hold them one. Give me that number.
Okay.
I tried to get everybody. We got women that don't get to come in here very often because they keep in the nursery. But we love them too. Let's try that again. You got to match a human body with this ticket. You know what I'm saying?
Okay. 3673.
Hey there, Sister Irene. All right. We got a small 38 pistol in there for you. All right. Let's see about one more. Drum roll.
3620.
There she is right there. I remember her coming in. All right. Let's give her a hand. And bless her heart, she's Terry's mother-in-law, but everything going to be all right. All right. Did we have a winner? We had a winner. Who was it? Camille? Oh, she's changing a diaper. I understand that language. Let's give Camille a hand for the other one. Amen. Thank you, darling. That was the one taped to the bottom of the basket, right?
I didn't take anything.
Oh. Well, good morning. If you would, this morning, I want you to turn with me to Proverbs chapter 31. Proverbs chapter 21. This is probably the most preached out of book on Mother's Day. Mother's Day. But studying it over again, I think I got some new things that may be new to you. I was testing the waters this morning with one of my Bible study colleagues. It was up here in the choir, and I kind of caught her off guard. Does anybody in here know who Lemuel is? Lemuel. Anybody know Lemuel? And she said, well, what's his last name? I said, don't give it that. And she said, you know what he's talking about in the Bible? That was Sister Diane, wherever she's at over there. Lemuel in the Bible. Now, I only know one Lemuel. He played football with my son, but this is not him, okay? Lemuel. We call him Lemuel or whatever. But we're going to speak about a guy today named Lemuel. And, you know, I'll tell you at best, they say that we really don't know who he is, but I got a real good idea who he might be. And maybe we'll learn together as we stand and honor the reading of God's word. Chapter 31, Proverbs 31. Did I tell y'all something different? What you rail girls talking about over there? Where's your glasses at, Ann? I hope you find it better anyway. Anyway, it's the last chapter in Proverbs, but here we go. The words of King Lemuel, the prophecy that his mother, listen to me now, his mother taught him. A mother that taught prophecy. Let's pray. Father, we do come to you this morning. We thank you for every lady here. God, as I've been thinking about them this week, and I think about my wife and my mama, and all the things that they encounter in their life. The curse of motherhood, of carrying the baby and having the pains, and but the love that you put in them just overshadows all things. God, and your word even teaches us it's the only thing we have on earth that's even close to Jesus' love. God, we thank you for that. God, we can sure appreciate you if you're better than that, and we know you are. And God, we just thank you for our mothers. As the song she sang, the secrets that she knew, the kind words she spoke, the instructions that she gave, and God, the nights that she was restless. God, we thank you, Lord, for giving her strength. The energy, Lord, to keep on when the body said no, she would say yes. We thank you for that. Lord, you built them different than you did man. And God, I thank you for that. God, be with us this morning as we look into your word. As we listen to this mom give her son instructions on what a good king would be. God, I thank you for these words we found. Help us this morning understand, O Father, your word. Let it be a blessing to our heart, Lord, that we would love our mothers. Lord, even as we compare it to Christ's love, we probably could be a lot better doing it than we have been in the past. Help us, Father, to love you and to love them. And all God's people said, amen. We thank you so much for that. And as you stand there, it talks about a man named Lemuel. Well, you can dig around and all you want to. Some say that it may be referring to a man named Hezekiah. But, you know, I really can't find how that could be, being that Solomon wrote all the precious words prior to this moment. And when we see it a little bit more. But yet he's got a strange name. So if it were to be Solomon, whom I think it would be, who they're talking about here, if that be the case, then it may be a nickname or a call name that she used, but she used it because in the Hebrew, the word Lemuel means devoted to God or for God. That even more makes me think that it might have been Bathsheba, David's wife, that may have nicknamed him or called him something as she referred to him as king. Now, just for giggles, if you have nicknamed one of your children, now some women, men, wives, husbands, and all, they don't agree with nickname. I nickname everybody. But if you got a nickname that you called your son or daughter, would you raise your hand? All right, Boog, lay it on us. So I call her Boog. Huh? D. D. Who was that? Oh, D. Anybody else? Miss Ruby, what'd you call Randall? Randall. Oh. And I would say that explains it all. Bubba, anybody else brave enough to do that? Miss Teresa, come on, you got something. I'm not talking about dummy or I ain't talking about that stuff. Anybody else got a nickname? Yes, ma'am.
When Pete was little, we used to call him Buddy.
You know, I called, Caleb's had so many names, it's just hard, you know, Junior, Bunk, Potlicker, I mean, all kind of stuff. But we had, any other mom want to share that? Yeah, most of you mamas wasn't, you know, it's kind of like, sometimes, you know, my real name's James. And I've been called Jamie all my life. My sister, we didn't call me James when she was a little bit older. She called me Mamie. And so Jamie got thrown in there, so I'm better known as Jamie. Been called a lot worse and all like that. But have you ever noticed, guys, that your wives, most of the time when she's mad, she calls you by your full name? When Jan calls me James, I'm in trouble. Honey, when everything is going okay. So, can any of the young people that are in here witness with me about your mom calling you by your full name when you get in trouble? I'm looking dead at you. I know she has. You did that. What about you? Yeah, she did that.
Caleb, she did that. Judd, you get. I've even heard Cricket say that. His really name is not Judd, it's Judson. But I've heard Judson a few times. It was, I knew there wasn't nothing good on the other end of that. But having said that, the fun's over. Y'all wasn't very fun. I know y'all got nicknames. Y'all just wasn't sharing them. They must not have been very nice, I can tell you. But anyway, Lemuel, I just think that maybe he was. But neither say that. Just say that he was and that his mother was Bathsheba. Y'all know Bathsheba, right? David was king, saw Bathsheba sunbathing or taking a bath on the roof, had her husband killed on the front line because she was a beautiful woman and took her to marry her, and she has a son named Solomon. That was a quick history lesson. So, but I think more of Bathsheba because of the first 10 verses here than you would ever imagine. What does mamas do? Mamas are closer than their kids, whether they be female or male kids. And they share secrets and they begin to teach them things along the way. Some private things, some things that dad don't never hear. Sort out some problems along the way. Mama knows all. And mama, let me tell you, mama can tell dad some things on down the road that we didn't know coming up because they valued their daughter or son's life with what dad might do to them if he found out. But anyway, we know that's happened. But here's are some instructions that Lemuel gets from his mother, whom I'm thinking is Solomon, to be a king. Now, I'm going to tell you what, that's pretty staunch. That's pretty strong in my book. Where's David? Well, to be honest with you, David wasn't the perfect example. David was a good example in his better days. But how did he get his mom? He stole her. So here's a woman going to explain what Solomon needs to be and needs to do to be a good king. Let's listen as we read. She says this, "What, my son? What? The son of my womb. And what? The son of my vows." When I read that, I think that she's talking about him. What, my son? What, the son of my womb? The son of my vows. It's like she's answering questions that Solomon must have had or may have had. And she's saying, what? What is it? And how she describes it, not only did she call him the son of my womb. You know, that's what's different. You know, Caleb and Cricket, they're my children, but they're not my children in my womb. My wife is the one that risked her life to have them too, as your mothers did and all that. And she puts that in there. In other words, she's showing the relationship that she has with her son here. And then notice what she says here, the son of my vows. Now, what was the vows? Vows she may have made to God. Vows she made to her husband, David. The very things. And she's letting him know that whatever we do in here will be sacred. And it's going to be straight from the heart. You know, mama sometimes, some kids think mama are naggers, but mama, all they do are reminders. Don't do this. Don't do this. Don't do this. Live like this. Do that. Listen to what she says. Here she begins in verse 3. She says, "Give not thy strength unto the women." When you study out in the Bible, what is she telling you? Don't be a whoremonger. Don't chase crazy women. Now, I'm not saying you women are crazy. Don't get that. But this is coming from a mouth of a mom. Was there any girl or any boy good enough to have your child? No, I don't believe you could get a fair answer from anybody that think that anybody else raised one that's good enough to take your kid. I happen to get some pretty good ones. But when you look at it, because I don't see that 18, 19-year-old girl that's ready to charge the world and do things, I don't see her in that picture. I see her, that little girl with pigtails, or I see the little boy with his baseball hat on. I see him in their younger years. I see him in all those things. That's how I see him. I don't see him as a grown woman or man. And here, mom is giving out some advice to her son. And great advice, may I say it. She says,
He says, don't chase the women of the world. Now, we know that Solomon, he may not have listened to all that, if this is Solomon. He had many, many, many wives. But these were for to be the king. These things would ruin a kingdom. Maybe some of these things ruin King David's kingdom. He says, give not thy strength unto women, nor the ways of that which destroyeth kings. Be careful. Look at the examples in the past. You've got written record of your dad. You got written record of his dad. You got written record of all those. Don't do those things that destroy kingdoms. She's preparing her son to be a leader. We don't see the image of his dad doing that. But we do see a mom doing that. Mom can talk seriously to the heart. Mom can, through tears, persuade them to do the things that they need to do. She's doing that. She's answering the questions. She's asking the questions. He says, in verse 4 it says, it is not for kings, O Lemuel. It is not for kings to drink wine, nor princes strong drink. There was ways, and it's going to mention some ways of drinking and stuff like that. And what he was talking about, you wouldn't make a good leader if you are drunk. If you stayed drunk all the time and you did this, and it mentions it also, what does it do to your mind? You know, if it's kind of like being a mama. You're on call 24/7. When is the perfect time that you would be drunk out of your mind that you couldn't render aid to your child? Dad, the same thing. When will it be appropriate for you to do that? And she's warning him. There's never a time that it is good for you. And he also mentions it of the princesses, which would be talking about his wives. When would be a good time to be caught not knowing what's up or down or not having your right mind to make a decision? Aren't you glad in the decision that he made, his first decision that Solomon ever made in the book was because of these two women that one woman's child died and she stole the other child from another mom who had the baby at about the same time, and he had to decide which mom got the kid. If he would have been at a drunken state, he wouldn't have come up with the idea that God inspired him, because all he asked from God was to be able to distinguish between what is right and what is wrong. The word in the Bible is used as discern. Discern between what is right and what is wrong. And she's telling him, you never need to be in that sort of predicament, my son. Your wives, the princes, they never need to be. What about the preacher? If he would have taken a good strong toddy or two at night and someone in the congregation dies at 1:30 in a car accident, would he be able to and be fit to go to the car or to go to the family in that time of need? This is what I'm trying to tell you. She's explaining that. Son, be on your best behavior. I think it represents Christianity. We're on call 24/7. We live and represent Jesus Christ when we're at home or when we're abroad. We represent him anywhere we go. Her description to her son, if you're going to be a good king, you don't need to be found like this. But there are times that this stuff is useful. In verse 5 it says, lest they drink and forget the law. She's telling him that could happen. And pervert the judgment of any of the afflicted. As I mentioned already. It says, give strong drink unto them that is ready to perish. You know what she's talking about there? Execution people. People that's on the fence and be executed. For wrongdoings and stuff like that. To calm them down, to put them out of the state of mind, it was okay, she said, I would think of that, because he would be in charge of approving executions. It would be okay to give that a sedative, so to speak, a drink of some sort, to get those folks out of their mind and prepare them for execution. That was acceptable. Acceptable. It's the same thing we do today. They didn't have, what you call that? Some people say, if I keep them kids any longer, I'm going to need a Valium. Yeah, something like that. But in those days, it was drink. They didn't have pills and shots and stuff that we have today. Need something to knock me out.
He says, give strong to them that are ready to perish, and wine unto those who will be of heavy hearts. What would that represent? That would represent I had a neighbor that died of cancer, and he didn't have insurance and all like that. And he was a dear friend of mine, and I've never known him to be out of the way with alcohol or any drug or anything like that. But I went to see him just days before he died, and I could see the liquor bottle stuck under his pillow because he refused to try to put the family in debt to buy pain medication for his, and he was drinking that to aid the pain. I thought no less of that man. I thought no less of that man for all that. And no, I'm not straining a gnat and swallowing a camel. I'm telling you, there's purposes in the Bible and purposes nowadays for things that we have to do in this life. I agree with those things. But it wards off what she's trying to tell him. It's okay for this, but it's not okay for you in the state that you're in. You're going to be king. You need to be in your right mind. You don't need to be driving back then. Verse 7 says, let him drink and forget his poverty and remember his misery no more. Open, verse 8, open thy mouth for the dumb. In the cause of such is an appointed to destruction. She changes gears. She says, you speak on behalf of those that can't do it for themselves. Do you understand what Mama's telling them here? Mama says, let me tell you, there's people that's going to be less fortunate than you. Talking about the dumb, not only that, the crippled, the ones that can't speak, the ones that can't hear, the blind. Have a place in your heart for them in your kingdom, that they be treated special because of what the situation is. Have that kind of heart. Have the mother's heart of that child in you and recognize what they are and be special unto them. It sounds just like a mama. You know, my wife, sweetest thing I know, and she'll see kids. She'll see kids in the hospital that's going through a surgery or going through treatments and stuff like that. It almost brings her to tears as she rolls through Facebook and sees these pictures. And she says, I couldn't work in a NICU. I couldn't work at, what's the kids' hospital? Wolfson, St. Jude's. I couldn't work there because she couldn't work through her tears because she has a mother's heart. And he's trying to tell them, your heart needs to be soft as a mother with these instructions. You need to carry those out, not to be so hard-hearted, not to catch yourself in a way that wouldn't be, that you would mislead or misdo the law and judgment on your part. You know, that's the worst thing that happens today with all the drugs and stuff we got going on there, is people do them and they try to carry on a normal life, whether they drive or work or what gets me is they'll get in a boat and run 60 miles an hour and try to jump, do flips off of it and think they're okay because they're Superman or Superwoman. Or dive off of the Burnt Fork Bridge. I know I could probably get a hand. There's probably some standing in here right now that has jumped off that bridge or dove off that. And I'm not going to ask you. No, I never. When I was too little and didn't know no better, we went down there one day, and I seen a bunch of kids there, and I asked my dad. I said, can I jump off of that bridge? He says, I'll beat you half to death if I catch you on top of that bridge. And he says, you know I can't swim, and you go under and stay longer than I think. He said, we'll both probably drown in me trying to get you out of there. So no, son, you're not getting on that bridge and jumping off that bridge. You know what? The older I got, it don't even cross my mind. If I was dying of something right now, jumping off the bridge is not what I'd be wanting to do. I can tell you. But those times when you can't see the future, mom can see the future because she's been there and she's done that. She's seen what happened to people that does things and treat. And he's trying to teach him, not only are I want you to love your wife and treat her right, I want you to love a nation. I want you to be God. I call you Lemuel for a reason. In the Hebrew, it means devoted to God. Stay devoted to God. I challenge each mom here today, be called Lemuel. Be called Lemuel. Be devoted to God. Who has the most influence at the house, inside that house? I can tell you who it is. It's Mama. Who tells you to get your feet off of that coffee table? Who tells you to pick them underwear up and put them in the clothes hamper? Who tells you it's time for you to go see the doctor when you get grown and you think you don't have to, and yet mama comes and she hugs you and she says, I think you got a fever. Why didn't daddy recognize that? Because daddy don't hug and kiss on you like mama does. We don't have that skin-to-skin contact like mama does. And he's telling them, Lemuel, you need to be a king that is close to his people. You need to be a king that is willing to set the example and live it before them. Be that person. And moms are. Moms are those people. Not all, but most, I believe. There's a lot of great moms. And one thing too, moms, I'll tell you this. Just because what you learned from your mama and your grandmama in the past about being a lady, don't let that falter. Teach them how to do stuff. Last night, my favorite lounging shorts. I don't know how it happened, but the button popped off. What y'all laughing at? My wife was trying to clean the kitchen because we cook together and we eat together and she cleans alone. So I wouldn't be without my lounging shorts. I dug around and found a sewing thread, and this is the second time I've put it on there. It ain't that I gained weight. It's just I think thread ain't as good as it used to be. But I was sitting there sewing that button on, and I looked at my job when I got through. I said, that's terrible. But you know, it's kind of like welding, guys. If you can't do a pretty weld, just put a lot of weld on it, because it's called gorilla weld. You weld enough to cover it. It's ugly, but it's tough. Gorilla. Well, that's kind of the way I sewed my button on. And I hate to tell you this, but I got part of my garment in with one of my loops in my button. And when I was about through, I realized that I'd sewed some of my over there on it. Was I going to redo it? No, ma'am, sir. So I tied a few more knots in her to hold. But as I was thinking about it, I says, you know, I would have never known this as a child because my mama would have had this done. I never would have thought about those busted knees because my mama would have had them done. My mama would have washed my clothes. My mama knew when to throw my underwear away and my T-shirts away. I come home the other day and my wife had done house cleaning in my underwear drawer. I said, where'd they all go? It'll take me 5 more Christmases to get caught back up. She said, they were terrible looking. I said, nobody sees them but me and you. But the thought of the future, the thought of what could happen, where you might be when you got a hole in your drawers. You said, Brother Jamie, what's all that mean? I could speak on and on and on. But all the little things they think of. All the little things. How many of you ever got in trouble for not brushing your teeth? I wanted my wife to make sure they brushed their teeth because I didn't want to spend no money on them at the dentist office. She wanted them to have a pretty smile. Didn't they not just get in there and run around in the shower and play, but they actually washed? My ears are as big as they are now because my mom had big fingers and she cleaned them out when I didn't do such a good job. And a snotty nose was like, you was terrible. And she would wipe it on anything. And when she didn't have anything, she'd use her bare hand. And black kids, y'all laughing because this happened to you. My mama hold me down. You're not going out in public. Well, I said, Mom, I can't even see it in the mirror. Well, I know it's there. It's the little things. Why does maybe only mama is the one that says, I love you?
Why is Mama maybe the only one that says, you know, this phone call is pretty good, but I need to see you face to face? When she sees you with her own eyes, she's x-raying you. She's seeing how you react and how you move and your facial expression to find out if everything's all right. And I can hear her say now, "What's wrong?" "Oh, nothing." And I'm sitting there going, "That's a lie." "No, you can tell me." Jesus said that about us. Mama's learned it from Jesus. He said, "Cast all your cares upon me." Why? Because I care for you. I know it's pretty tough. I remember one time, never had many stitches in my life, but I got one time. And I remember my mama, she was pregnant with my sister, playing baseball with older boys. And not bragging, but I was pretty good at the age I was. And we were winning. We only played with like two or three bases because we didn't have but about three on each team. But I was fixing the score, probably the winning run, and I was making around on a dirt road. And a boy that thought he was a baseball player had steel baseball cleats on. Instead of him not being able to beat me to the bag, I don't know what happened to my speed. It just left me somewhere along the way, but I was gone, boy. I slid into third base. He tagged me all right with that front cleat right in the calf of my leg on my side and laughed. My sister saw blood. She thought I was dying. She ran against my pregnant mom. She carries me to the car. I'm talking about almost as pregnant as me. Carries me to the car. Usually faints at the slight sight of blood, but because it was mine, it would not faze her. Carries me then to my dad, who carries me then to the emergency room there to get sewed up. And she says, "I get woozy even thinking about it back then, but for some reason it did not affect me at that moment." Jesus died on the cross of Calvary because he loved you. He's willing to spill his blood, to take a whipping, to take those nails, to be mocked. When right on the tip of his tongue was access to thousands of angels to come and get him down. But he says, "Nope, I love you too much. I'll be the sacrifice." And that's what he did. Listen, my friend, love your mama today. It may be the closest thing to Jesus you've ever encountered in this life. She knows, and she cares. And you know what? We need to let them know. For what Jesus done on the cross, I believe your mama would try to do for each one of us. It is a special day. Any old gal can have a baby. But there's only some that are really moms. Moms that walk the walk and talk the talk. We don't hear any a lot of bad stuff at Bathsheba at this time. Husband, not so. But her, yes. Ladies, thank you. Thank you for being who you are. Accept how God made you. Be proud of how God made you. We are different. I don't want to be you. I don't think I can.
I'm not built that way. But I was loved by a mother. And then I married, and I got my second mother. Husbands, love your wives as your mother loved you. Lemuel, be a king. Follow these instructions. And a popular verse that I'm going to end with then, it asks the question, who can find a virtuous woman? Well, if you could buy one, it says that you couldn't even use rubies or diamonds to buy one because they're worth more than that. Thank you. Go with God, and He'll go with you. Things may not always be pretty. Some of the saddest times of my life at funerals is when a mom buries her kid. It broke Dad's heart, but the blood she shed to have him is now gone. I cannot have that relationship because I cannot do that. She does, as Jesus did. Love Him today because He loves you like your mama. Let's pray. Father, let us read more and study more on how to be the person we need to be. As Bathsheba explained to Solomon, which we believe that's who this is, how to be a king and a leader, how to show kindness, how to be a pain reliever, even one with a nervousness awaiting death or illness to death, how to come to that need as moms do. God, I pray today we can see that. We can look in our mom and see what Jesus is like and really know that if we don't have Him, we need Him. If anybody could be more special as you are than our mothers, we sure need that. God, I pray we'd look at our hearts. Bless these moms. God, you give them a tremendous job. Let us raise our children in the way that you see fit. And God, you'll keep your promises. That even when they get out of the nest, God, things go south. But if we raise them according to what you tell us, they'll come back. God, we hold to these promises. We pray, Lord, that you would melt our hearts, remove pride, Lord, and become a Christian today. And to be an example today to our kids. Go with us now. Have your way in this invitation hymn. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Thank you.
know if any of you grannies or grandpas have still got one of them. Y'all remember the little rubber things that you had in your pocket that's got change in it? That you squeeze, it's kind of shaped like a football, and you squeeze it. And you stick your fingers in there, and it... Well, it wouldn't hold enough money to buy a piece of bubble gum now, but I remember when penny candy was a penny. Some of the sweetest moments I had with some of my grandparents when I wanted some, especially my granny. She'd reach in there and she'd find that little plastic thing that she had. Every now and then she'd have money hid. It'd be a dollar or something, real money. She squeezed that thing up and she says, "Baby, just get you 4 or 5 cents and get what you want." Jesus said, "If you'll come in and sup with me, I'll sup with you." And he opens that little rubber purse. He says, "Get all you need. Get what you need. And what you need is me." We're going to sing one more, okay? Think on this. One more book. Today, I love y'all. Y'all girls have a very happy, merry, enjoyable, and I hope someone made you a biscuit Mother's Day. Amen. Tell you what I want to do. A mama here that's around family and friends, I want y'all to squeeze up next to her. Y'all go ahead and do that. Pack it in there. Show some love. I'm going to pray for y'all, okay? Y'all pray with me. Father God, as we've grabbed our loved ones, we thank you for the ones that's the center of that household right now. God, I pray a blessing upon her. God, I pray you pour out a spirit of love and mercy upon that family as they hug and depend on that one. And God, that the man of that house would be the man. And God, that he would let her be the woman of that house, the mother, Lord, that raises those children in a manner which is pleasing unto thee. God, be with them. Strengthen them, God, because they work when everybody else is gone. God, we love them. Give them a blessed day today. Let them wear a flower of proudness that, yes, I am a mother. I brought life, and I'm giving my life to lead the way. Go with us now, Father. We thank you, Lord, for what your Spirit's already done here today. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen.